Our gospel lesson today comes from Matthew 25, verse 14 through 30. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with the 2 talents received the 1 and gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with the 2 talents also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master said and replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received the 1 talent came. Master, he said, I knew you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out and hid your talent in the ground. So here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant, you who knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed? Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have in abundance. Whoever does not have even what he has will be taken from him. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please be seated. This is an interesting parable. When I taught Sunday school back in the day, I used to love the parables because they really helped me to understand better what God's plans were for us and where he wanted us to go. And then reading the lectionary for today, because we try to follow the lectionary because there are a lot of people that do in their readings at home and such, I came on this parable and I went, oh, the one parable that I probably least understood growing up. Why would God throw out the person who had the least? And then I did my research, and Pastor Scott provided me with lots of materials to do my research with, and I realized I hadn't interpreted the parable correctly at all. The parable is really about our faith and our willingness to serve God. It's about the treasure chest isn't about physical treasure. It's about the treasure from the Lord and opening our heart to the Lord. It's interesting in the research to find out that talents were coins. And one of the most interesting parts is that one talent is worth what would have been the equivalent of about 15 years of salary. One coin. So the man who had 10 talents was suddenly exceptionally wealthy. These were gold pieces that we're talking about. And it like just blows my mind away to think about that much money in those times. And then the other fella that increased his 2 talents to 2 more talents could have just squandered it away. They could have just run off and done their thing and not given any back to the master. But what about the guy who didn't do anything with his talent? He really didn't take on the challenge, did he? He hid his talent in the sand, in the dirt. And the interpretation of that scripture is that's kind of like when we hide our head in the dirt by not sharing our Christianity, by not sharing our faith, by not praying for others, but just worrying about ourselves. That's a selfish thing from the very beginning. Courage, it says, is the, I always start out with definitions and such, the ability to do something that frightens us. And like I mentioned to the kids, bravery. It takes bravery to get through that fear, to confront uncertainty. It takes courage. Every day when we get up, we have to confront uncertainty. We don't know what lies ahead for the day. So hopefully we're all praying that we have the strength of the Lord and God to get us through those things. Everyone sitting in here has had various types of challenges. And every one of you have confronted them, have conquered them, and continue to pursue on. I know for a fact that every one of you sitting here today in this church have demonstrated your Christianity, have shared your stories, have asked people to pray for you when you've needed the extra strength. God is quite exceptional. He takes us on our good days and our bad days. He doesn't throw us out with the garbage when we haven't had a particularly good day in relationship to Christianity. He has the patience of the saints. He is a saint. He's our Lord. It was the exceptional love of God that was really being shown by the generosity in entrusting the talents. That's how they're defining this parable. It also demonstrated God's willingness to self-limit so that we can exist and live creatively. God hasn't created a mold that says you have to do it exactly like this every step of the way. He allows us to lean on our faith and Christianity to be creative, to decide how we're going to apply those elements to helping others to interpreting the scripture and living by his commandments. He keeps it pretty simple. And this was one message, and I hate to call them sermons because I don't want to feel like I'm really preaching when I need people to preach to me, is KISS. KISS stands for Keep It Simple, Stupid. Christianity does not have to be complicated. By giving us space, God has demonstrated his love to us. By not always doing for us, but letting us learn by our mistakes, by our failures, by not always understanding why things have come out the way they did. They're all tests of faith, and it's hard sometimes not to get angry at God or Jesus because things haven't come out exactly like we thought they would, like our game plan for life. But those are the areas where God leaves us to decide how we're going to proceed and to demonstrate our faith in him. Using our gifts encourages us to discover and use our gifts and abilities to the glory of God. The slave used their own creativity and energy for their own delight and blessing. The third slave neglected the opportunity and did nothing. So he was ultimately punished. And all scripture throughout the ages has said, if we don't, and all scripture in the Old Testaments and everything, where Jesus gave people ample time to become Christians, and the Lord looked down and told them, you know, that he would bring them out of Egypt into the promised lands, and many people still chose to worship their idols and their false gods. And those people were put to death oftentimes because God had just reached his limit. They did not display any form of Christianity whatsoever. I think the biggest challenge that I have, and I would challenge you with, is your faithfulness cannot be static. It can't be just, you know, okay, I'm a Christian. I believe in God. That's not what Christianity is all about. You can't be static. You have to be creative. Charlie is putting on a turkey dinner for the community. That certainly isn't static. Eric took over the realm of the roast beef dinner and doesn't even have a bleeding ulcer after it occurred because people came together like they will for their turkey dinner, like they will for anything else that we undertake. We are a small church, but our superintendent has said, we are a strong church. I did not make a copy of it, but I received a notice from Bishop Scholl that we have reached 100% of our apportionment. That's amazing. It's amazing. We're a tiny church. That's not a small amount of money, those apportionments. That go to the University of Africa, they go to, UMCOR. They're all designated in different modalities. And we met our 100% of expected apportionment. That's amazing. That's why we get those certificates that Kara puts downstairs. We bury too much goodness. We need to take time to love, to treasure, and to not put our talents in the ground. Because our talents truly do mean our talents, not our money, but the wealth of our Christianity. Why is this parable? It is fear and distrust that paralyzed the third slave. He rejects his master's given opportunity. So as I said, what we do in response to God's trust is neither trivial nor incidental. We have real choices and power depending upon how we choose to use it. We have been given stewardship over something far greater than our own lives or even this planet. We have been given the scripture, the law, the gospel, and their good news of the relationship with God that we know as Jesus Christ. At the expense of going a little bit out of context, I was looking through different scripture, and I've always, again, as a child, you know, trying to understand things and things. I think all of us growing up, one of our favorite things is to read the Psalms. Excuse my allergies. They're just, maybe now that we've got this frost, they'll all clear up. But I went to grade school in an era, I'm dating myself, when we actually read the Bible in grade school. Our teachers could give us assignments to read various things. And I can still remember one of my assignments was a psalm. And I was going to Sunday school and such, but it was in third grade or fourth grade. But, you know, I was reading, and it opened my eyes to the Bible, more so than I had even in Sunday school, because in Sunday school you always had your lessons and your topics that you went through. And when I look back now, I think, holy cow, they're not even allowed to say "In God We Trust" in school nowadays. But you can read the Psalms. And the Psalms are the stories of David, and I've always enjoyed the stories. So when I was looking through the Bible, I felt this psalm was very apropos to what we're talking about today. It's Psalm 113. Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the Lord in the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God? The one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and on the earth. He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes, with the princes of their people. He settles the barren woman in her home as a happy mother of children. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Therefore, like we read in Ephesians, we want you to be strong in the Lord. Put on that full armor of the Lord. It gives you strength. Refer back to those passages and let them help you. Pray. Prayer is the foundation of our faith. Ask for understanding during our prayer and why we are confronted with the elements that we are. But stand firm in that belt of truth and with that breastplate of righteousness and put it in its place. Look for a practical spiritual invigoration. It doesn't have to be complicated. It can be very practical. Preach out, as discussed by Pastor Scott, and reach out. Share your Christianity. Invite people to participate with you in prayer. It doesn't have to be complicated. I finally got brave enough to tell patients I would pray for them. I've put patients on our prayer list. I've stood in the recovery room or in the hospital and prayed with a patient or two. I've taken them a prayer shawl. It doesn't have to be complicated. It opens their eyes to the power of prayer. And especially because most of the individuals that I work with are during crises of illness of different types, they're more vulnerable to opening their minds to prayer. But you can tell the guy at your gas station while he's filling your tank, "Thank you. Have a good day. God bless you." It's not difficult. People won't think you're a religious zealot like I used to think they would. In fact, they might even seek you out afterwards. Not in a complicated fashion where they ask you to recite scripture and such, but just knowing that you have a kind heart because God made it so. Our church isn't meant as a place to hide it, but it's meant to serve as a foundation of our faith. And now, if you would please bow your head with me in prayer. Dear Lord, as you guide us along the way, help us to grow as spiritual adults. Help us that we pray for courage and strength, optimism and faith to meet every challenge along the way. Help us when we lack the will to reach out for our dreams and when demands on our time interfere with the spiritual disciplines that you have brought into our lives. Help us to keep them in sight. Life is full of surprises, the good and the bad. During times of the bad, we realize how significant and meaningful our faith is. As a result, we pray that you will teach us to reach out to you as you taught us to pray. And please join me, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I have a hymn for us, Beverly.
Well, I just have one more thing before we start that.
Okay.
Do we have any? We have to do our affirmation of faith, and then I'll have you do the hymn.
Okay.
And then I'll do our prayer concerns. Our affirmation of faith that I selected today kind of goes in line with what we've been talking about, can be found on page 887. And I had no fit. This is an affirmation from